Welcome! We are live again. My name is Fabian Westerheide, an entrepreneur and investor with a passion for artificial intelligence. This is the Rise of AI Virtual Chat, a series of conversations with interesting people from the fields of AI and technology to learn, to understand and adapt AI. This is episode 18 and you will be here live. You maybe will watch the replay or you will listen to the podcast one day soon. Also, this is the last episode probably for this year because we will take a break to focus on the hybrid summit which we have upcoming here in Berlin and virtual in November soon. Also, this is a unique edition because we have a co-host called or named KI Park. And KI Park is, I would say, a loyal partner of ours. And I know what means loyal because during Corona, we had a lot of struggle, a lot of problems, and you learned who's your friend and who isn't your friend. And KI Park was loyal to us. They have a very motivated and smart team there. We are thankful for them. And this is a way of giving back this thank you too. What is KI Park doing? Well, they are building a network to drive AI adoption in Germany. They do publications, they do events, they are building huge AI server park and infrastructure park outside of Berlin, which will be hopefully coming in the next couple of years. But they also currently already run an innovation platform where you match AI startups and business and public entities. So their mission is to increase AI adoption. And this leads to the topic today. Our topic today is chances and challenges with open innovation. And I take Germany as an example, but this is speaking for all of Europe. We have an old industry. Just taking the DAX, the largest 30 companies of Germany, they have an average age of 110 years. Merck, 300 years old. ThyssenKrupp, 200 years old. Siemens, 160 years old. Companies like Delivery or Telekom, Infineon are among the youngest. Just imagine, Telekom is like the third youngest company or fourth youngest company which we have in the DAX. So very young company in contrast. Also, we all have seen it during Corona that Germany is not digital yet. Schools, education failed. It failed. Public services failed. We all know the tools out there and it didn't work. If you want to go in front of court, setting up a Zoom call with your judge didn't work because they didn't have a computer with a webcam. All this. I say Europe is dying, but very slowly since the First World War, and we are too big to fail. The future isn't here. The future might be China. It might be the United States, but it's here not for a while. Why is that and how can we turn this around? Well, for this I have invited Marcel Otto Yon as our guest today. He's a serial entrepreneur and he was doing AI before it was already cool. So his first company in the 2000s was doing facial recognition, and everyone who has a passport, his technology is in every passport there, which is in Germany and other European countries. I mean, his company invented the technology to have your face inside a passport and other services. His second company was doing image recognition for cancer detection. And just to give you an example how he did it, well, he was running both companies here in Germany, but he IPO'd them in USA and Australia. So again, invention, Germany, management Germany, but the growth, the market, the adaption outside of Europe. He's also the founder of EO Germany, entrepreneurs organization, EO Europe. He was part of the EO Global. EO is a network of entrepreneurs. I've been myself part of it for a couple of years. I can highly recommend to you, if you're an entrepreneur, check out entrepreneurs organization because it helps you a lot to not be alone. If you have a lot of trouble as an entrepreneur, you always have ups and downs. EO is a very, very good tool and network to support you. And then the last 4 years, he was the founder and CEO of the German Armed Forces Innovation Unit. And he was trying and he achieved it, but he didn't close it because it's an ongoing process to help one of the largest institutions in Germany, the Armed Forces, to become innovative. And I would say, let's welcome him here. Hi.
Hey Fabian, how are you doing?
Oh, I'm doing great. The prep talk we had before, we didn't stop talking, and I think this is always a great indication that this will be a very interesting talk today. First question for you. You said 2021 will be a hard year for innovation because a lot of corporations will, for the upcoming recession, cut down on innovation hubs, etc. You said that isn't good. Tell us why innovation units is something good for companies and how you see this development in the next years.
Yes. And you know, maybe to put that in perspective, my comment is based on the experience out of the 2000 burst of the bubble, when we saw quite a few corporates close their corporate venture capital units. You know, at the time it was the big hype end of the 90s to create corporate venture capital activities, which I believe was a great idea. A lot of companies, however, in the aftermath of the crisis, just closed the units down. And I think we may be seeing something similar happening to all these innovation units. Why? Because I'm so these corporate innovation units are not always doing well. Why aren't they not always doing well in the eyes of the corporation? It's because it was in the past couple of years very hard for them to get out of the pilot phase, of the kind of prototyping, ideation kind of phase. And I mean, of course, my recommendation is different. My recommendation would be to keep and rather strengthen these activities. And I have visited over the last couple of years so many of these units, and I find they have done a terrific job. But very often, the corporation could improve significantly the way they interact with them. So it will be interesting to see how that develops, actually.
So from market perspective, all these innovation units, I mean, there was a saying there are more accelerators than startups in Berlin. From market perspective, from startup perspective, it was very hard to work with them because they didn't have budget, they didn't have the right people. But from internal perspective, they may be useful. So what is your experience? What worked? What is a good example of an innovation unit? And what
Yes.
is their task to internally?
So from analyzing all the military innovation units in the Western world and about 50 corporate innovation units, I saw maybe five themes reoccur for those that were particularly successful. The first one was when the corporate leadership understands that the key benefit the startup ecosystem is bringing is not ideation, but is actually execution. So, you know, that's the real strength. It's not about having the idea, it's about making it happening. The second theme is the question, who does the innovation unit report to? So we have seen that the most successful ones are reporting directly to the organization's CEO, and those that are struggling tend to be reporting to the CIO or to the CFO or to the second level management or somebody else in the organization. And the truth is, if you really want to be disruptive, then there's only the senior management, the CEO, that can help you, you know, achieve that disruption. The third theme we have seen is a very interesting topic, and that's the question of what is the relationship and the expectation towards the core business. And what I've seen is that those units that were meant to be competitors to the existing business were the most successful ones. So a lot of organizations want to do this in harmony. If you really want out of the box disruptive innovation, your innovation unit must be a competitor to the existing business. And particularly in Germany, we like to think that competition is something bad. Of course, we don't want them to stab knives in their backs, but competition is actually something very creative.
It's very natural. I mean, everything is competition out there.
Absolutely. And also behind competition, there's another concept, and That is the idea that there is not one truth. There are several ways how to be successful. There are several ways how to establish business models. And if you don't allow this diversity, you'll be confined to one truth. The fourth theme that we have observed is the question of handing over of the innovation project. So there seems to be this idea that innovation units are there to create an idea, maybe test it, and then hand it over as soon as possible to the core business. And we see this fail all the time. And so the better version is to let the innovation unit grow and ultimately become a new core activity. And the fifth driver was one of the team. So we have seen that the most successful innovation units managed to create a mixed team of both people from the organization, from the core business, but also that are able to attract experienced serial entrepreneurs from the outside world. And I think this is also a very underestimated point. We'd like to stay in our comfort zone by saying, oh, it's so important to know the organization. But I think it's important that we have people that bring outside experience, but also that they don't know that it cannot be done in the organization, that so to speak, lack the respect of the status quo.
So I sum it, it's learning from execution, it's CEO focus, it's internal competition, it's growing it, and it's mixed teams. Just example, Walmart, for example, they tried to go digital for 4 attempts. They started it, did it 3 times, they did it internally and integrated it too fast, and it was killed by politics internal. Only the 4th time it worked because the CEO appointed a co-CEO who was doing only virtual digital.
Absolutely. And let me give you another example. The US Air Force did something like that. So they have my great friend and colleague, Lauren Knausenberger, who was responsible of the digital innovation activities and who just got promoted to be the deputy CIO of the US Air Force, which, you know, let's remind us, is larger than the entire German military. And so this is another great example where an entrepreneur has moved into the core and into the very senior leadership of one of the traditional organizations.
Okay.
And I think this is exactly the right forward.
I had similar learnings when we talked with Uli Waltinger, who's head of AI at Siemens. He said, like, everything has to be CEO level. The CEO needs the reporting, and then you need the execution power to integrate everything, but you need to do it in the business unit itself, etc. How can it? So it's so critical that the CEO needs to get this. And then we speak about, where do we have in Germany an entrepreneurial CEO? Like running a large company, where do we have this mindset already? Like any company comes in your mind where you say, oh, they do it right currently?
I'm not aware of any. And I think this is the question behind that is even broader than that. Let's look at the C-level of our largest corporations. Mm-hmm. So I tend to think that the C-level ought to be looking into the future of the business, where the business should be in 10 years from now. Mm. So in my thinking, the C-level should reflect the business that we want to have in 10 years from now. However, when you look at our largest automotive businesses, banks, and so forth, you see very successful people there. They're great people. Some of them I know personally, they're absolutely smart people, but they are representatives of the old way of doing business. Now, we all know that our car companies, our banks are not going to be like this anymore in 5 years from now. So, and I'm not saying that the C-level boards should be composed out of startup entrepreneurs exclusively, but I'm saying that there should be, if you want a more entrepreneurial business, if you want to move to fintech, if you want to move to autonomous driving, there ought to be a certain diversity of the entrepreneurial skill in the C-level suite. Because let's remind ourselves, there are 100,000 other people in the organization that know how to run the existing business. It's not about running the existing business. It's about preparing the business for the future.
Well, that's interesting because I follow this discussion. We both agree it's a question of culture and leadership. And a lot of newspapers from manager magazine who are shareholder focused, let's say, no, the CEO is appointed to run the current business and to save the business model. And this is what the shareholder wants. So we could argue first, the shareholder do the mistake that they don't appoint a visionary one because they are too greedy to invest in the future and they rather want to cash or milk the cow as long as possible. Second question there, or argument is there, how can then middle management or management innovate? Because if it's all depending on the CEO, this is highly frustrating and that could lead to them, oh, I don't have to do anything because the CEO doesn't do it, then I don't do it either.
Well, let's be clear about one thing, because there's this funny thing about us humans. We always point to another person when something doesn't work, okay? So middle management points to C-level, C-level points to management, and so forth. The truth is, of course, that every single person in the entire organization has a contribution to make when it's about the cultural transition. So I've had a lot of these discussions with, I would call this senior middle management, people who are responsible for 5,000 people, a billion in revenues, etc. And they very often tell me, oh, I can't do this and that because my bosses wouldn't allow me, the structure, our organization is such. And this is something we hear in particular in the military. And that is true, of course. But at the same time, it's also true that these senior middle managers have quite a lot of decision power within their own organization. And when you ask their employees, they will kind of say the same things about their boss. So so it's something that affects us all as leaders, and it's probably the most difficult thing in the world. But having said that, we have seen these examples where it has been able to transition to a different kind of culture. And I think this is what we need to bear in mind. It's a cultural transition from critical mass to critical initiative. In the old days, critical mass was an advantage in itself. Today, it's a disadvantage because it makes me slower. So I need to move my organization to what I call critical initiative. So how do we create an organization where everybody assumes responsibility, takes initiative, but without incurring too many risks? So that's always the hard part. How do I balance good governance and initiative?
You asked the question I would like to ask, how do you do it? I mean, you told us what's important, what's a success factor, but let's assume, because this is about innovation, how do we get more innovation in? The ideas are out there, scouting them, not a problem. I mean, startups are very exposed, but how do I start? I mean, how can I change the culture from the old way we used to do business, which is shareholder focused, to I'm willing to disrupt my own business and build a business model which is lasting for the next generation?
Yes. Well, what's interesting is that in most organizations, the team, the people, actually have a good feeling about what doesn't work. Now, the difficulty is they only know a certain fraction of the problem. So it's very difficult. You need to be extraordinarily smart to be able, from your portion of the slice, to be able to draft a recommendation to senior management on how to change the entire system. Mm-hmm. So I think as leaders, what has worked very well is we need to enable and encourage a discussion. So the starting point is always something where an employee is not with frustration in the room. That's the starting point. But that's when the real work starts. And as leaders, we can play an incredible support by moderating that discussion. Because one, we have the experience of analyzing complex problems. And secondly, we have the overview of the entire organization. So it's a question of moderation of this frustration, I would say, and to encourage conflict and constructive conflict, and to work together on solutions. And the organizations that have implemented that have actually been successful in a very, very short time frame. I think you can initiate transitions within months.
You have examples?
Yes. So one organization that I've been following closely, which I find extremely interesting, is the Singapore Military or Defense Ministry Procurement Organization. So this is, we're talking here about the most conservative kind of organization, the Military Procurement Organization. And they have embarked on an extremely interesting program to change the culture. And I have not seen in any military in the world a program that was so well thought through and so much focused on culture anywhere else. And they have introduced it, of course, only in a small area, but they have now moved it in the like project management area. They have now moved it to the core, to the finance people, to the legal people, to et cetera, to all this, right? And so we are now talking the fourth year of this transition. And I think we are seeing right now the pivotal effect it has. And so an organization of something like 5,000 employees is showing immediate effects after 6 months and has changed the entire organization after something like 4 or 5 years. So that is kind of the speed you can develop to change a large organization.
So I take it, it can change even in public entities who are said who can't. So there's hope. We could turn around Germany in our industries in 5 years if there would be the willingness. Now there the question, how do you generate the sense of understanding? Example, I was talking about AI for a large German company, you know, 1 billion revenue, Mittelstand, and all the innovation people who invited me like, yeah, great, we need this. And all the CEOs, like very old white guys, like my father did this way, my grandfather did this way, I will do it this way, we don't change anything. Bam. I told them, hey, Alibaba is running, by the way, the same solutions, offering for free, and they can crush you in 5 years and you won't even see it coming. Listen to me, they don't. They don't. They believe everything which worked in the past will work in the future. We both know disruption isn't this way. How can you expect? How do you get this into the mind that history is not linear?
Yeah. So, I mean, let's bear in mind that this corporate transition of culture is probably one of the most complex things around. So there is certainly no silver bullet and there's no, you know, one fits all kind of solution. What I found as a recurring pattern is the question whether you focus on advancing your offerings or whether you focus on technology. So particularly in Germany, we like to focus on technology. So so a typical organization would say, oh, we want to have more AI. So you have a very modern thinking CEO that will say, oh, we want to have more AI. In reality for the organization, it's, you know, it shouldn't be a driver whether there is more or less AI. The driver should be, is our solution better or not? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, the other experience is it's incredibly easy to build the technical solution. It's actually very easy. It's much more difficult to create the change of business model. And let's remind ourselves, a disruptive technology always comes with a disruption in business model and market and all this. Otherwise it wouldn't be disruptive. So, and this is what we are struggling about. It's not about building the disruptive technology. It's about all the other things that need to happen. So this is a good idea to focus on the business side of things. The other aspect here, of course, has to do with, I mean, you indicated that the traditional, the wisdom, it's, what brought us here, what made us successful over the last 20 years is not gonna make us successful necessarily for the next 20 years. So there is kind of an conscious and unconscious bias in any organization. And ultimately, when you think about this, I think the only way to tackle this is through allowing more diversity in leadership in the entire organization, but particularly also in leadership. So bring people from other sectors, bring people from other worlds, like bring people in from the military, from startup world, from academia, etc., and then you will be able to overcome this inherited wisdom and all this.
How can we bring, because diversity is, we all know it sounds easy, but it's so hard. First, you want to have the same qualification. I know it. We host a conference and we had in the past people saying, hey, you don't have a 50% ratio of female speakers. And I said, like, if you give me 50% of equal qualified female speakers, no problem. But the market is like 1 to 10. They are like so less. So it's significantly harder. The other thing is, yes.
Do you mind if I challenge you on this one?
Please.
So we tend to think that diversity is about gender only. And of course, this is important.
It's background.
And by the way,
a lot of,
German Innovation Unit, we had 40% women. So we're talking at a crossroads of military, startup, and IT, right. And we still managed to have 40% women. So it is possible if you really want.
I agree.
But the true thing is it's about diversity. It's not about gender diversity. Mm-hmm. So let me give you two other examples of diversity. The size thing that we touched upon. Our way of thinking about leaders, about recruiting, is always size matters. So the way headhunters and CEOs recruit their team is to look at, if you have managed 1 billion in revenues before, you're now ready for 1.5 billion. If you have managed a 20 million revenue startup, you're not ready for some reason for a 2 billion revenue company. And so this is a good example of diversity, because I can tell you that a good startup entrepreneur will bring so many more things to the table because he has actually gone through the difficult pivots of finding these 20 million in revenues, which is a completely different task than from managing an existing business. And typically, startup entrepreneurs are thrown into the cold water. So they have seen every single function, whereas the middle management and corporations very often have only seen one or two functions. They're salespeople or they're finance people or something, and they have much less diversity in the corporate functions and skills, etc. So this is just an example, but there's also diversity at the level of psychology. Mm-hmm. You know, we all know there are people that are more cautious, that yes. protect us from incurring stupid risk. That's very important. But we also need people who are the pioneers, who are not afraid of taking a step into the unknown. So it's about that balance too. And do we have diversity in the C-suite? No, we don't.
So there's a saying, A players hire A players, yeah, but yep. B players don't. And a friend of mine, he worked for, I think, Red Hat, which was, he said, like, the first 1,000 people, that was fine because there were only A players in the team around the CEO, but then it got bought by a larger corporation. They kicked out the A players because they didn't want to share their power, and then all the others left, the talents. How can we make it that diversity means also I give away power? That means someone that will challenge me, someone will question my task. That also will mean I have to give a little bit of my budget or of my business models away because he will disrupt it. How can we convince people to not stick on their seat on power? Because politics is doing the same for years. I mean, there are no role models out there who really provided diversity and change. And even all the leaders which we have are diverse female, act very male in their position.
Yeah. Well, at the end of the day, we are in a hierarchical system. So it starts with the shareholder, and look at the board of directors, the non-executive boards. Mm. There's no diversity there. There's zero diversity. And some of them, I mean, yes, they have taken on board a few women.
Even on the side of the employees. I mean, the Gewerkschaften, they are not even diverse, and they should be.
Well, that is a very particular phenomenon in the German German legal system, and I fully agree. The question is, you know, who do the employees put forward as board members? But let's put that aside because it's a very special and yes. complex thing. There's the other half of the board members that are being appointed by the shareholders, and even there we don't see much diversity. And so it really starts there. And if shareholders really want to make sure that their large corporations and their enormous valuable assets make the transition, I think they should appoint more diverse board members. And then these board members will appoint more diverse C-suite teams. And then that will cascade down into the company. And at the end of the day, there's no right or wrong here. I want to be very clear about the startup world is not better than the corporate world. You know, I'm just saying there's good in both, and in other worlds like the military, they are good in all these worlds. And I think we just get more if we are able to include the good of all these worlds and make a best of.
Okay, I would like to look for a second on abroad and outside of Europe. For example, JP Morgan, during the financial crisis, they hired right after 1,000 machine learning experts and started to scale and automate a lot. Deutsche Bank, they honestly suck. I mean, they don't do well anything innovative there. Why are the Americans over and over again, and JP Morgan is an old company, able to reinvent them and be adaptive, and we don't do it? I mean, what are the advantages the Americans have? China outside, because it's a different, younger system. But what can we learn from the United States and cultural and leadership and diversity, etc., and adapt here?
Yes. So I think the examples that you're mentioning go back to this diversity and to this culture topic we have been discussing. So I don't want to expand on that anymore. We have covered it. But let me share the experience of an entrepreneur that went into the US. Mm-hmm. And what I find is, and we're talking here about B2B and B2G. So selling to businesses and selling to governments versus selling to consumers. Mm-hmm. So the sales cycle, the time needed to make a purchasing decision by the corporate in Germany, in Europe, is about 2 to 3 years for new technology. In the US, it's much less. It's somewhere between 6 months and 12 months. When we talk about B2G, business to government, in Germany, it's around 10 years. Yes. So that's what it takes. You know, when we invented facial recognition, we were at a phase in particularly after September 11, you know, where every single Minister of Interior in Germany wanted our technology, where all the people working in the engine room wanted our technology, and still it took something like 10 years before the first revenues, the significant revenues came. Yeah? And why is that? So there are a couple of drivers here. One driver has to do with the willingness to assume responsibility and to be accountable for results. Mm-hmm. I think in America, we're seeing executives that are held more accountable to moving things forward. In Germany, we like to hold people accountable for not screwing up. So there's a bit of a difference in mindset.
So for example, politicians, when they do a fault, they always have to resign so they can never learn from their mistakes. This is something I don't understand, because it's like, hey, you do one mistake, you're out of the system, so you can't learn.
So politics is taking this to the extreme, you know, but maybe, you know, maybe that's another
and then,
session altogether.
And then you mess up something like the airport, and there's no responsibility and accountability in there, and you have sunk billions of it.
Well, so let's just one comment on the public sector. In the public sector, we have the concept of Zuständigkeit. Mm-hmm. It's there's no real translation for this in English. It's the person that is allowed to make a decision, mm-hmm. which is distinct from Verantwortlichkeit, so the responsibility for a result.
Okay.
So what we love to do in the German public sector, we have the Ministry of Defense, mm-hmm. that is, or any ministry is the same, mm-hmm. that is responsible for making the decisions, and then you have the layers below who are responsible for delivering a result. Mm-hmm. Well, that doesn't work. My mother told me you cannot share responsibility. Either you're responsible or you're not. Mm-hmm. And so this is a very tricky point. And also, we love to share this responsibility over many, many, many people. I think there's no way in the German government, a public sector, you can make a transition, you can introduce a new technology with less than 100 signatures that you would need.
So we come to the point where we just discussed, you said it takes 10 years to get a technology into it, which is terrible because I know that our drones, which don't fly, but if they would fly, they would fly on DOS. I know this from suppliers. And this is just an example. So will this change, or is there any innovation how this process can be reduced from 10 years to maybe 3 years? Or this is not scalable.
So the first question is it possible? Mm-hmm. And the unit I was allowed to build in the German military had to address particularly that question. Mm-hmm. Is it possible within the very complex legal constraints of the public sector and the very high demands of the public sector to do a procurement system that is faster? And the answer is, of course it is. So, for example, we designed a process from ideation to delivery into the hands of the soldiers in 3 months. So it is possible. The European procurement law requires you to have a tender out for 30 days. It doesn't say 3 years. Mm-hmm. So it's more a question of organizing the workflow, organizing processes, etc. Mm-hmm. And what we see here is a debate about the old functional organization was the new cross-functional team. But, you know, we're kind of drifting back to the culture question. Let's go step back a little bit for the question, what works differently in the US? Mm-hmm. So another thing that I witnessed there was the focus on the solution rather than the technology. So let's take an example in the subsidies. So in Germany, we like to create public incentive subsidies for artificial intelligence that will say, you get subsidies if you do a research project on artificial intelligence. What if we did something saying, we will give money to the public transport company of a local city that manages to introduce the first autonomous bus. Mm-hmm. So that would be more result oriented.
Like the DARPA challenge, a little bit like giving an incentive for results.
Or in back 20 years ago, what we saw is there were subsidies in the US system that gave money to sheriff departments or to state police or even federal police to introduce new technologies. So it created a market, it supported the market demand for innovation versus financing a push of technology. And there's a bit of a difference. And of course you need both. But in Germany, we tend to have only the technology push.
Yeah,
and it's very important.
Grundlagenforschung.
Excuse me?
Grundlagenforschung, very German word.
Yes, but even the angewandte Forschung, the applied research, is extremely tech push oriented. Mm-hmm. And by giving purchasing demand to the user, you are actually not only pushing for solutions rather than technology, but also you're making sure that the products created are such that somebody can use them. You know, this is a thinking that is much more embedded in the US, or actually Australian and to some extent even British culture. It's much more result oriented.
We understand Australians, they are entrepreneurs because they built the country. The same about the Americans, the American dream, but the British as well. And I mean, the British are better in AI than we are in terms of startups, funding, etc. and this metrics. Do the British have this mindset too, being more result orientated?
I have, I mean, you know, everybody has his own experiences. I was allowed to make some very positive experiences in dealing with the British government and British companies. And mm-hmm. I found there was a very big openness to innovation, which was remarkable. And of course, let's not forget to mention Israel as a country, which also is, of course, very innovative and result-oriented.
Yes. Yes. We have a question here from the audience. Otto, do you have examples of European, and now it switched my tab, of European innovation projects which worked? So companies or anything where we can orientate, where we say at least it worked once. So cooperation which was more innovative or which accepted yes. innovation, internal, outside, something like this.
So just to be clear, by innovation projects, you mean like digital innovation units, or you mean any innovation?
Let's stay with successful innovation projects outside of, it doesn't have to be digital, it has to be successful.
Well, I mean, innovation projects, there's so many successful innovation projects. And let's come back to the German military. Mm-hmm. The German military is highly innovative. If you look at the technologies they use, we're just missing a culture of innovation. Mm-hmm. That's a bit of a difference here. And innovation projects, are there successful ones? Of course, because I mean, Germany continues to be one of the leading nations, one of the high-tech nations. We have mm-hmm. produced some of the most amazing products. So behind all these great products, there are so many successful case studies of innovation. But maybe the way I understand this question is more geared towards digital innovation units. And if you ask me, do I know one that is perfect? The answer is no. But I see a lot of good in a lot of settings. And of course, you have to differentiate also between the innovation unit itself. Most of them are actually quite good, have remarkable teams and have great ideas and have great projects. I would say by and large, if these innovation units fail, it's more the opportunity is more on the side to think about how do they interact with the corporate. And that's more a question of what does the corporate design for them to, so for what can they do, what they're allowed to do or not, and how they are they in the structure of the overall organization. And again, there on both these accounts, there's no perfect one, but there is enough lessons learned you can draw from those that are existing. I think, and there's enough publications out there. It has all been written down already that it's actually not that complicated to craft the right system. It's more the question whether you have the real willpower to do it in the right way.
So I have one example which I like. It's not perfect, but it goes in direction, which is Visman, which is building heating systems. And they have launched Vito One, so they have an early stage fund. They have a larger company builder fund, and which is run by the family itself. So it's a little bit family office capital too. And they really, they buy and invest financial and strategic into startups without integrating them, but to learn and to adapt this. And I think this is a very good approach. So I'm a big fan of, hey, you have to invest into the future technologies without thinking to buy them, just that you learn and then you adapt, etc. Like Bertelsmann was doing this for years, and then they stopped it, by the way. Axel Springer was doing it, and then they stopped it, by the way, too. So I see this waves also coming, that they do it and then they stop it.
Yeah, and it's a great example. And you know, with the new generation that has taken over at Wiesmann, there's a new young leader that is bringing in some of that entrepreneurial mm-hmm. culture, etc. And there are other so-called hidden champions that are amazing companies. Of course we have these great examples.
So I would like to come to point the back how we can innovate public entities like the army, but also like everything which is public services at the end. You say there are 100 people on average involved into signing a technology purchase at the end. That means there isn't the top only, there are like so many others involved. I know it's a culture question, but how can we start? I mean, how can we give some something inside the system, like, because every one of us is out there and is able to change that, this moves in the right direction. It's I feel like overwhelmed by this task, and if we're overwhelmed, yeah. We say I don't do anything.
And it is an overwhelming task because it's so big and it's so complex. You know, the public sector is 45% of the German economy, and that's pretty big, and they have a lot of responsibility to deal with, and so it is complex. Having said that, is it possible? Of course. And there are many things we can start at the operating unit level. Every unit leader can do something to change the culture today. Mm-hmm. At the same time, if we really want to build a greater public administration, we also need to start at the political level. We need to think mm-hmm. about us as voters. And I'll give you an example. The good leadership, good governance of the public sector is not a political topic. We're never discussing in the political agenda mm-hmm. how do we make better leaders? How do we make better entities in the public sector? And the excuse is always, we're not here for profit. We're, you know, it's a non-profit thing. It's the government. So, you know, that's always the excuse to say all these leadership things that tend to come from the corporate world are not relevant to us. And that, of course, is not true. So I would say the most important thing is to introduce the question of good governance, of good management, of professional management, of leadership diversity into the political debate.
Mm-hmm. Okay, before we continue, I have a question there too. I will read out the results of the polls I have asked there. And I, for example, asked, does Europe lag behind in adapting innovation? And the majority of 57% says yes, but Europe can learn from US, China, how to be more open towards innovation for society. And one third says we will stay behind because we aren't hungry anymore. Then asked what is the main driver for innovation, and they said, and they shared with you, 57% said it's culture, and the other third said it's talent. This leads to my question, your personal experience being in the army, which is for me the nightmare of being modern, what was good? What did you achieve? And you said, like, hey, I achieved this in this work, but also, where did you fail? Because we all know you couldn't have succeeded in everything. Where did you get against some boundaries where you said, I couldn't push them, this didn't work?
So, before I get into this, let me rectify one perception. The military has phenomenal people that are very entrepreneurial. And that is particularly true if we look at the troops in the core of the business, when the soldiers are in the field, when they do the core business, it's actually a great organization with great people. The challenges are more in the, let's call it, corporate headquarters, right? And in the senior commands, and it's in the military bureaucracy, really, both civilian and in uniform. But, you know, to answer your question more specifically to our unit. So first, I think we had and still continue to have a phenomenal team there that has done an amazing job. And I don't think that it could have been done in any better way in any shorter time. Mm-hmm. What was particularly successful, I believe, was the building of the team. We built a team of officers and soldiers from the military, particularly from the cyber special forces kind of backgrounds, but also from the startup ecosystem. We have several serial entrepreneurs in the team, etc. And I think that happened in a very short time frame in extraordinary quality. The second thing is we managed to implement that every project was done with the user, with the troops, with a battalion, with the operating level. So that was very successful. So in 80 projects that we initiated, it was always the troop involved. We always assumed that we would know what the military needs. Mm-hmm. And so that was highly successful and it worked well. And the interaction with the comrades was extremely positive and successful. The third thing that was really successful is the interaction with the startup world. Hmm. And let's remind ourselves that that was an unknown. Some people said startups don't want to have to do anything with the military. Now, in my experience, the contrary was true. Everybody was very willing to cooperate with the military. And in particular, when they understood that the military is not only about weapons, it's also about healthcare, about logistics, about administration, about so many things. The fourth thing that was highly successful is building partnerships. And here partnerships is a little bit with the corporate sector, but it and the startup ecosystem, but in particularly it's other military organizations from our allies in the US and France, Netherlands, Singapore, Israel, etc. And I experienced so much openness, so much camaraderie, so much willingness to help among these innovation-oriented people. Now, I also witnessed what it means to have official dialogue of cooperation with another country. Mm-hmm. And that was the most bureaucratic processes I've ever witnessed.
Okay.
But when you strip it down of these diplomacy and bureaucratic elements, cooperation is there. And we can be proud to have really great allies. And I can tell you, without the openness to and willingness to share experiences, we would not have been willing to, we would not have been able to build this unit so fast, and, you know, in particular with the US military. And the fifth element was, I think we were wise to recognize from the beginning the change is about communication. So we did a very good change communication policy. We had the strategy of building a bottom-up community of change makers, and so that's a community that, to my knowledge, today has something like 10,000 members and is growing 10% a month. And so that's like the bottom-up rebellion, and I think that was the right strategy. And for example, the unions, the employee representatives, which in most corporations are difficult to deal with in these periods of change. In the military, we're actually the fiercest supporters of our movement.
Okay. Time-wise, that's why I speed a little bit up. I know that you also had backlash. I mean, you're a guy, extroverted, entrepreneur, bold, you wear red pants, which was a cultural clash. And we both know, and you know even better, you got public really insults. I mean, they hit you very, very ugly, private family. I mean, you had people attacking you. And I asked first, why? And second, where was this coming from? Like, who was afraid of you that they had to run propaganda against you?
Well, people have to know that everyone who tries to make change, disruptive change in the German military, will get anonymous emails and letters from some idiots in the system. I'm convinced till today that it's a very, very small number of people who have chosen to take that path of being saboteurs.
Okay.
It's not the majority, not at all. I'm fine with it. Why? Because I have so many great and positive experiences of people encouraging us, people standing by us, that this dwarfs next to it. But you just have to be aware that unfortunately this happens. And the only thing that I regret or I find sad is that the public sector seems to be incapable of dealing with these saboteurs. So in some instances, you know who they are, but the public sector is incapable of throwing them out. And we're talking about a handful of people. Mm-hmm.
We know it, that one commenter is saying, hey, this is not right, and then 99% don't disagree with him public enough. I mean, it's the internet, it's a very small voice can be very loud.
For the system is such that we're not talking about constructive criticism. Mm. We're talking about saboteurs. Let's remind ourselves of that. And so unfortunately, the system, the way the culture is, gives them quite a voice. Yeah. And that's the real problem. You will never have a large organization without one saboteur. It's unfortunately there are people who choose to take that path, but the question is, how does the organization deal with them, and how does our political system deal with it? And this happens at I know generals that have been treated extremely badly. Simple employees that have been treated extremely badly, and that's very sad because it's killing initiative.
Mm-hmm. Okay, 3 minutes left, and just aside, Chris Boos, for example, who was at our virtual chat before too, he had a similar backlash. He wanted to do a Corona app. He invested millions of his private capital in there, and he got attacked so much by some public voices that he was very, very painful hurt. He struggled with this, and I know that he suffered under this, and he's a good-mooded guy, but he says like, hey, I try to do something good, and you get a lot of beating, because the beating voices are very often higher in the public sector than the encouraging voices.
Yeah, but hey, if you want to be a disruptor, if you be an entrepreneur, be prepared for resistance. That's the way it is. It's the same thing when you're a startup entrepreneur. And actually, I think that is one of the reasons why we should have more startup entrepreneurs in the C-level of corporations and in the public sector, because entrepreneurs are so good at dealing with these obstacles.
I like to say that being an entrepreneur is like being in a boxing fight with endless rounds. Like, and all you can do is take the beating and get up again, because there is no way of giving up, then you're out. So you have seen, and let's at the end turn to AI a little bit, because you have seen AI coming and going before. You have experienced a whole cycle. Where do you see us in the cycle currently, and what is to be expected in the next couple of years? Because you have experienced it.
Yes, there's so many deja vus here, because you know all the great ideas that are out today, we had, you know, they were out there 20 years ago, and there were great companies working on them 20 years ago. However, a couple of things have changed. First, the technology has made tremendous progress. It's amazing what it can do today. And secondly, there's so much money around. And also the role of startups is very different. I mean, 20 years ago, there were a few crazy people doing startups. Now it's like mainstream. Mm-hmm. And so I think the speed at which AI is going to develop is going to be so exponential. And I think this is why it's so dangerous, because that's the whole point about the exponential curve. For like years, you think it's not working, it's not good enough, and within a time frame of 1 or 2 years, the curve will actually go through the acceptance level, the minimum acceptance level, and 1 or 2 years will be too short for the large organizations to adapt. And this is why exponential technologies are so dangerous for big organizations. It's not that they don't understand it or they couldn't cope it, it's the change to the organization cannot be done in 1 year. So, I mean, I would say if you don't start really, really, really hard, I mean, it's like 5 to 12 right now. I think that the next 5 years will be pivotal in the industry.
But at the same time, you said it's technology is not the bottleneck, it's the culture and it's the adaption for it. And so you say that the hype will not go down for AI like the deja vu you had before, because let's be honest, AI disappeared in the knowledge or in the awareness of people for 8 to 5 years. A lot of researchers said, I used to do AI and now we call it cognitive science or machine learning, because AI was a word we didn't use for 10 years.
Yeah, why is it so difficult to implement AI? Because most AI applications are B2B business problems. And as we discussed earlier, decision-making process and complexity, to be fair, it's just longer in B2B. And so that's why we're not seeing more AI today. It's because of the lack of innovation culture in the large organizations. So two things can happen. Either we'll see these large organizations change, either COVID is gonna be the opportunity to really make two changes to talent diversity and to culture and all this, and then the German corporations actually have a tremendous chance because they are world leaders today. So if they adopt a more entrepreneurial culture, they are unbeatable. And the other outcome is that we will see the emergence of more startups, and they will just beat the corporates. I'm not part of those people who think that the Western world will go down the drain and Asia is going to take over. There are some phenomenal people and phenomenal companies in Asia, and you know, there should be enough space on this planet for everybody. I think we will more see a shift towards startups in Germany rather than Germany going down the drain.
Otto, great words. I mean, giving us hope. We can do it. We can pull it off. It takes only 5 years to change a very large corporation if you want to. We learned a lot from you. I thank you for this. I will excuse you now. Everyone else can stay on the line. Thank you for being here today.
Thank you so much. Take care.
So that was great. That was also a good closing for our series of virtual chat, which we end for now. It's the first season, 18 episodes we had. If you're interested in AI innovation, you could check out the KI Park, because they have a huge database and access to a lot of solutions. So if you think about, okay, how can I do it? How do I get to the core technology? How do I find corporations, partners? KI Park is offering you this. On the other hand, if you have some innovation and you want to get in contact with enterprises and public sectors with Stage Forever, KI Park is building the platform and the matchmaking for this. Sign up for the summit if you haven't done it yet. We're streaming it free. It will be like today, just with the stage and everything around. We use a lot of our learnings from the virtual chats to do an amazing hybrid summit. It was a pleasure. I had such great talks. I learned so much in those talks. And I know I had some really hard conversation partners, and I had some really nice conversation partners. So I learned also a lot of myself. I had growth in the eight last talks. You learned a lot. We have a platform. We recorded everything. It was wonderful to have you here. I hopefully see you back to the next season. Enjoy your day.